All right, so a lot of you guys, if you've heard from me, you probably hear a lot about disturbance. And most people, when I talk to people, I glean from them, and also when I talk about it, I'm usually talking about disturbance strictly from the perspective of fire or some sort of timber harvest. But the fact of the matter is, disturbances can be far more varied than that. And Florida is a pretty good case study of this, where water is a pretty important disturbance agent, and sometimes it is a disturbance agent that is also paired with fire, and that seems really weird. We're standing in a place that is exactly that right now, and we actually have quite a few rare plants that are here that are wetland associated plants, but wetlands that are flammable. So what we have in these kinds of systems is this really weird water cycle, where water is keeping a lot of woody plants, you know, trees, from growing in an area. And a lot of the plants also are right at that interface with the uplands. And in the dry time, when the water recedes, they become really flammable and they're part of that upland fire regime. You know, there are a couple of important things for you to think about. One, that disturbances can come in many different forms. And some, you know, if you're a waterfowl hunter, you know that. You use water as a disturbance like that if you're managing moist soil wetlands for waterfowl use. But it's less intuitive generally, and we probably use it less as a management tool often. The other important part, and I think the Florida is a perfect case study for this, is how important the environment is in shaping the biology of species. And a lot of you are probably really familiar with the rut with deer, for instance. And wherever you're at, I'm guessing more than likely you're in a place where the rut is somewhere in November, or it may shade one way or another, and then you start getting into some parts of the south, and maybe it's in December or even in January. But in Florida, just within the state of Florida, we have deer breeding in about 10 months out of 12 during the year. And one of the things that is shaping that and making it so widely variable is the different disturbances that are affecting the environment. They're also affecting the biology of the animal. And when we get down to South Florida, where it's pretty hot, if you've been to South Florida, you know it's pretty warm most of the year. We don't have severe winters, but we do have a wet season. And that wet season is a limiting factor for those deer populations. So we literally will see into the deep south part of Florida, we will see deer in peak rut in maybe July or August, and then we might see peak fawning occurring in January and February when the ground is dry enough that the fawns will not drown. So you can see how important, that's an extreme example, but you can see how important the environment is in shaping the biology of the animal. And it can, you know, Florida is a really great case study because it shows you how extreme that pressure could be and how much it could shape the biology and really kind of turn things completely upside down. Now, another really unique thing about Florida that I'd like to add is when you get to South Florida, there's been some really interesting data collected on white-tailed deer, especially where they overlap with the Florida panther. And the Florida panther has an activity pattern that's generally around dusk and through the night. And what we see when we measure the activity pattern of whitetails in that same range, their activity pattern will be diurnal, and you'll see it hump-shaped, where the majority of activity is centered in the middle of the day, right around noon. It is hot at noon in South Florida, but deer are still most active then. And that's another way, you know, that the deer's behavior is being shaped by its environment, which is really, really cool, but also important for you to understand, because the same thing can happen, and we all talk about it, with hunting pressure. We could be shaping the behavior of the animals, and that's important for you to consider when you're deciding, you know, how to hunt a property if you have access to one.